thanks so much. Yeah, so mandalas, it's a really big topic, you know, because a lot of people think, oh, it's just a, like, mandala is actually Sanskrit for circle. And people think, oh, it's just doing those drawings like those adult colouring books. But there's a lot more to it. So I want to explain to you about that tonight. So I'll just go to the next slide. Sorry. Yeah, sure. A bit too loud. All right, I'll just find that. There we go. All right, good. And present. Where is it? Present full screen. Present. Ta-da. Okay. So, when we want to, people think that it's just about, that communicating to each other is just about words, but we can never really fully express the inexpressible. And so much of our world and our life is something that we can't really fully understand. And that's why all of us get interested in something like this in Theosophy in the first place, trying to understand something that's not possible to understand, and then realizing that you're never really going to understand it, which is actually really exciting. Like, there's no beginning and there's no end. So a circle has no beginning and no end. So I just want to show you a little quote from Erwin Watermeyer. Let's see if I can take that with me so I'm not stuck. There we go. So here's Erwin Watermeyer, FRC. So I do have a fair bit of stuff here from the Rosicrucians because I have done a lot of training with them. And you would have seen that image, I'm sure, before of the iceberg, how it's only the tip of the iceberg that we see, but there's a whole lot more underneath. So, our consciousness, what we can, I look around the room and I see people and chairs and paintings and things like that. So that's our conscious understanding. But the subconscious, there's just so much more going on, and it's much deeper than we can imagine. So that's where the iceberg picture comes into reality. So according to Erwin Watermeyer, the only way that the subconscious can receive any impression is in the form of non-words, images, and symbols. So this is really, if you're thinking about the concept, for example, of manifestation, which has to first of all come from visualization. So visualization is like the 4D world, if you like, so that bridge from the 3D to the higher realms. So if we're wanting to, so in order to understand anything, like our brain and our soul does not communicate with words but with images and symbols. And then there are symbols that are very traditional, and then there are symbols that we create for ourselves. So it's really quite endless. So just that bottom section there, to communicate with the subconscious, the message must first be transformed into a symbol or image. And to impress any image upon our soul, our inner self, we must first of all visualize and imbue it with energetic charge or emotion. So we need to have a real strong feeling about something for it to exist. Have you had the experience where there's something that you want and you've maybe not even said anything about it, but you know you really want it and it just turns up, and it's a simple thing, and you think, oh, wish I could do that with some other things in my life. I know I really wanted to buy this coffee table, and I was like, to think about that some other time. And then I found it on the side of the road. I was like, wow, thanks so much, God. You obviously heard me this time. I'm going to keep asking. Anyway, let's go to the next page. Okay, so let's think about symbols. So what do these symbols mean to you? So you should know I've been a teacher for over 30 years, so I like a little bit of response from the audience. I don't want to be just standing here and talking all the time. So what do these symbols mean to you? What about the one on the top left? What does that mean?
It's love.
It's love, but it's black.
It's
love. Cards. Okay. All right. And then the cross and the tick? Right and wrong?
Paperwork,
tick, cross. Oh, there you go, and then it reminds you of a song. So you see, symbol can create so many different understandings and imagery in different people. So, and then what's important also, the colour, as we were describing, with like the black heart. So what kind of person buys these brands? So we all have a concept about what kind of person likes something. Like, what kind of person buys, what's that? It's even got a name, Swoosh. It's got a, isn't that amazing? Nike. So what kind of person buys that? Sporty? Sorry? Pretentious. Oh, okay, yeah. See, yeah, but this is all the ideas that we have, and it's that, you know, becoming aware of that. What about the bottom left one? What's that one?
That's
not a label brand. Mm-mm. No. No. Looks like. That's fair trade. So when you buy chocolate, and you have, so, you know, when you buy chocolate, you look at the back. If it has that symbol, it means that they didn't have children in Africa, you know, slave labor. So, yeah, it's always good to try and buy that chocolate. Anyway, plug for that fair brand. Fair trade. So, I mean, to me, that's a really positive symbol and I like it and I want to contribute and I'll pay another dollar. So, you know, we all have different opinions about different things and it's all about our life experience and all the things that we've been done or said and, of course, our upbringing and all of those things that contribute to our concept of what things mean. Okay, so, yes. Explain what you mean.
Well, the tonality resonates with us. That be a subconscious message acceptable
to us. Yeah, so what I'm thinking is saying is, for example, Ted was when with the black heart reminded him of a song. So we have different modalities within ourselves. We could be more of a hearing person or more visual or more tactile. So we will tend to view things through those senses as well. Does that, is that? Oh, back more?
Yeah.
That one?
Forms, images, symbols.
Uh-huh.
So music as a
symbol. Oh, yes. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So we're going to look today because essentially, you know, there's the drawn idea of a mandala or a symbol, but then it can also be a musical sound which has a shape, you know, and it can be a texture, it can be a few different things. Okay, great. So most people here would have heard of Carl Jung. He's a more recent discovery for me, such an amazing man, incredible knowledge. And so you can see that image on the left is the first mandala that he ever drew. And some very interesting imagery there. And when we look at it, we could get a lot of different meaning as to what was going on in his life. But if we look on the right side there, it says, "My mandalas were cryptograms concerning the state of the self, which were presented to me anew each day." So when he discovered mandalas, he set about drawing them every day. So he'd draw a circle and then just see what kind of evolved from that. So it's all about being free with yourself and allowing that subconscious to come through and getting out of your own way. So if any of you have tried you know, any kind of psychic training or anything like that, excuse me, sorry, then you'll find that that you have to get out of your own way because we have so much of our own concepts. So you're trying to hear something, you know, for someone else or get that information or that message. That's why we get a lot of our information when we first wake up in the morning or when we go for a walk and we get that aha moment or we understand something or we get some information. So he's using the mandala really to help to understand himself because this whole concept, the more that we understand ourselves, well, the more use we are in the world, isn't it? Because we're not just being robots and just doing things automatically. We're actually becoming more self-aware and individuated. So so he says down in the bottom right there, so in them, that is the mandalas, I saw the self, that is my whole being. So you can see all of himself in the mandalas. Sorry. So if we have a look there, he says that the the mandala is a schematic form of the cosmos. So it's the microcosm within the macrocosm, or the macrocosm within the microcosm. It's this whole concept of the ocean and the drop in the ocean. So there's also this idea of like a universal consciousness. In the Sanskrit, they call that the Akashic records. So that there's something that we all dip into. So we have our personal kind of consciousness and then like a universal consciousness. So it's through doing things like drawing mandalas or experiencing mandalas in some way that we can become more aware of who we are and become our full selves. So it's a process of reintegration with ourselves, like coming back to who we are. Yes?
A question, and I've never thought about this before. Every time I visit a psychiatrist, he gets me to interpret what I
see. Oh, that sounds fun.
or people will look at the clouds and you'll see faces.
Mm.
And you do a conscious construct around something which gives you a whole lot of variables out that fits your subconscious messages. It's often up. The mandala appears to be a sort of a semi-conscious procedure in doing about the same thing. Would that be right?
There's different ways to approach the mandala. So one is in the Jungian method where you've got a circle and basically you relax, like maybe some meditation or some good music or breath work or whatever it is that helps you to relax, and then you just allow yourself to flow and, you know, no rules. But another style of using it is as a meditation, which we're going to have a look at shortly. Okay. Sorry. And then he also talks about the concept of the archetype. So that's when the archetype first came in, recognizing that the different symbols have different meanings. But we'll look at that a little bit further. Okay, so mandalas are multidimensional and they're considered to have three principles of order. So there's the center, there's what radiates from the center, and then there's the periphery, the outside. So when you draw a mandala, you know, you might really focus on the middle, or you might be someone that draws on the outside, and that all has different meaning for you. There's like I say, there's symbols or there's ideas or there's colours or there's numbers or there's forms that have a universal meaning, but there's also the meaning for yourself personally. So when you see that black heart, you know, it makes you think of that song, and that's your personal understanding. But then there's also a universal concept of what that means. All right. So when we paint them spontaneously with self-abandonment, we help to awaken the unknown creative forces of our unconscious. We find our own primordial rhythm. We can heal, replenish, and reconnect. So indeed, there's the concept of the colour, the number. Now, the number could be like there's a number three, but it's also that an image has three points, for example. So the number is not necessarily just a straight number, but how many of something is or how many edges or corners, you know, there could be. The form, the shape, and the sound will come up to that. So, and when we draw a mandala, we might find that it brings up different emotions. Like it might make us feel a bit angry or frustrated or annoyed or, oh, what am I doing this for? You know, I could be doing something else. And so you're working out that shadow part of yourself as well and letting that be expressed. And it's upon reflection afterwards that you usually get the meaning for something, sometimes while you're doing it, but very often afterwards. So the Gnostics say, God is a sphere whose center is everywhere and whose circumference is nowhere. And I love that. So you've got to think about a mandala being spherical as well. So it's not just a flat 2D thing. It's, it has a more tangible shape and form. Let's go to the next page. Okay, now this is where I have some notes. So these pictures come from a book called Creating Mandalas, which you can get in the bookshop. Just thought I'd do a little plug for the bookshop today. And you know, if we look at the first one there, just a plain circle, so that one has a lot of different meanings. So it can be like something that is eternal. It could start or finish anywhere. It could also be to do with nothing. Or it could be to do with like perfection, the sacred, like we have a sacred circle maybe. And then there's the concept of the Ouroboros, which we will look at a little later. When we have the symbol with the circle and with this dot in the middle, so according to alchemy, this means the sun. And it can also be considered to be like there's a point of consciousness and then it radiates and expands to somewhere. So there's another way. But again, like I say, it's all about your interpretation. So what I'm doing today is I'm going to give you a few different interpretations of some symbols. We're going to do a couple of meditations, and at the end, you're going to have a look at a couple of mandalas and see what you think they mean. So that's the purpose. All right, so the next one there with the spiral. So one thing that I have learned is about how we think that our learning is linear, but in fact it's a spiral. So we can be learning something and then we go and learn something else and we come back, or we learn something to some degree and then we have to continue it and then we start to see the link. So in fact everything is a spiral. So it's like the next level up, if you like. The one with the line across, so in alchemy that means salt. And according to Suzanne Fincher, this means the archetype of the maternal substance. So that's how it's seen by her. And then the next one in alchemy means saltpeter, but according to Suzanne Fincher, the vertical line represents the divine all-pervasive energy. So you can kind of imagine like the energy of the divine coming into the soul. So again, it's entirely up to your interpretation. I'm just going to give you a few different interpretations. Going to the middle at the top, the circle with the cross. So this it can be considered like the cosmic cross. It also has quadrants like north, south, east and west. It could be to do with the elements, and in the center is the quintessence or the fifth element. So, again, all about how you perceive it. Then the next one is the swastika. So that's a very bendy swastika. So there's basically a cross that's moving. So the idea is that everything flows. So as long as there is creation, energy, you know, exists and there's a flow. And then finally, the yin-yang. So you would have seen that many times before. So like the masculine or the feminine concept, it's not meaning man or woman, but the concept, and that within the masculine is the feminine, within the feminine is the masculine. So, and you might have seen this in the middle of the Korean flag, so with the I Ching all around it. So obviously see it as a very important symbol for the whole nation. Okay, so on the right side there, those are little drawings that are made by Nordic children like hundreds of years ago. So you can see the idea of a mandala is not modern. It's not just adult colouring in books. It has been around for a long time, but that's from centuries and centuries ago. And I've also got there the, we were talking about the spiral, like the Fibonacci spiral and how you know, the plants, and particularly you see with plants, you've probably seen with the fiddle head of the fern and how it, all of nature, oh, can someone just turn off the switch? The coffee machine starts to do its own thing, starts cleaning. It's very clever. Yeah, so the Fibonacci spiral, the concept here of sacred geometry. So speaking of sacred geometry, this is called the seed of life. So when the cells of the male and the female unite and they fertilize, then and they go from like two cells to four and so on, this is the like the one of the first divisions. That's called the seed of life, which is the beginning of creation. And the next one, the flower of life. So this one is, you know, expanded more and more. And you can try and imagine that again in like a spherical shape, and it just keeps going and going. So this image, I mean, I've seen it in Egypt on the temples there. I've seen it in India. We have it engraved on stones in Australia too. I think it's near somewhere in Victoria. There's some stones there with like Egyptian hieroglyphs. They did come here. And also this flower of life. So the idea that, you know, the mandala, the circle, it's been understood way beyond when we had a microscope, and that sacred geometry is, again, not just a necklace or a set of earrings, because that's what it's turned into a lot now, but it's, in fact, you know, the way that creation may start from a point and then it divides. Now, I just want to show you something funny. All right, let's put that there. Hang on a sec. So, all right, let's see if I can do this nice and easy. So, when I was doing my research and I was looking for the image of the first mandala that Jung ever made, Carl Jung, I found this website, and it's called How to Create Your Own Mandala. So this is what some people call the new age or modern way of thinking, which obviously we need, but it's kind of amusing. I'll show you why. So here are the steps. I'll read it to you. So it's one is meanings of mandala, two, make your own, and then it's all the rest is AI generated. So it's just horrifying, isn't it? I couldn't believe that, and I thought, well, you know, things have changed. So it's really seriously, you're going to get another consciousness to express your own. So, you know, the whole idea of doing some kind of mandala drawing is to express ourselves, not to give it to someone else to do. All right. So I'll just expand that again. Perfect. All right. So, yes, the question was about sound. So, indeed, and in my last lecture, I spoke about the chakras. I was always saying chakras, but I've been corrected. It's chakras. But the chakras there, so we've got the seven main chakras, and each of them has a sound. So like vam, was it lam, vam, ram, ham, no, yam, ham, om, aum, yeah? And each of them has a colour, so the colour is very significant. And then each of them has like flower petals, and so the more you get from the more base part of ourselves, like our physical, to the more spiritual, there are more flower petals. We become finer and finer in substance. So, and then each of them has a symbol as well. So that symbol between the two circles in the red on the left, that is the lam sound according to Sanskrit. And Sanskrit, of course, is a very ancient language. And it was written not because, you know, some angry school teacher was forcing you to do it, but because that was it was downloaded information on some level, that that's how you draw that sound. So we're going to do a few rounds of aum just to settle into our bodies. So if you'd like to close your eyes, put your feet on the floor. It's better to have your feet uncrossed. All right. And here we go. We'll just do... Just close your eyes. Feel the weight of the body on the seat. Feel the weight of your body on the seat. Feel the weight of your head over your shoulders. Feel how your shoulders are directly above your rib cage. Your rib cage above your hips. And feel the weight of your sit bones on the chair and your feet on the floor. And we're just going to do three ohms. Let's inhale deeply. Inhale. Inhale. Inhale as much as you can. Inhale. Deep breath, more. Just keep your eyes closed. Keeping your eyes closed, just feeling the sensation. Observing that sense of the no mind. Allowing yourself to be in a state of peace. A smile on your face. Just turn up the corner of your mouth a little bit. It's kind of funny. Let's rub our hands together, eyes closed, get them nice and warm, place the hands over the eyes, gently opening the eyes inside the hands, and when you're ready, moving your hands from your face and coming back into the room. Okay, so this little sound mandala makes such a change in such a short time. And there's been a lot of experiments done where they've got a metal plate and they've put sound through it and they've been able to get different patterns. All right. So here are the ways that some different people express themselves through mandalas. This is the Tibetan sand mandala. You may have seen this perhaps. And it's fascinating if you look at the guy on the right, he's got a metal tube with the sand in it and he just taps the tube to get a little bit of sand out. So, and they spend hours and hours creating it and then at the end they brush it all away. You go, what? How can you be doing that? But the whole thing is that, you know, that anyone who looks at the mandala is believed that it will raise their consciousness amongst themselves and meditating and praying while they're doing it, and that energy expands throughout that whole area where they are. Maybe you've had the experience of going to a place of spiritual significance and before you got there, noticing that all the colours were brighter, or you could smell better, or you could see better, or everything looked a little bit different, and then you realise, oh, I've just arrived, you know, the temple is just around the corner. So, you know, it affects the whole energy imprint all around. But then they destroy it because there's this whole understanding of, you know, whatever, there's the creation and there's the destruction. This next image here is, so the Native Americans also do sand mandalas. It's pretty fascinating. Now, theirs can be just decorative and for, you know, like creating a mandala in a group. But here we have a shaman. And the different quadrants have meanings, as you can see here. So the north to do with the wind and the bison, the bull. You've got the creator in the center, the west, the water, and so on. And they will actually create healing mandalas. So the purpose of that is like maybe someone's unwell, and so they'll pray and make these mandalas and sing and dance. And then once they're finished, then they throw all that sand away in the river because they say it's taken on the toxins of whatever it is that they're healing from that person. So they really don't want to keep it. Okay, so this is a mandala drawn by Harvey Spencer Lewis. So he was the American that brought Rosicrucianism from Europe to the West. And he was the first imperator of the order. And this is a mandala that he designed from archetypal alchemical concepts. And it was actually given to people in just black print, you know, and you colour it yourself. So he coloured, he created a design and actually he's coloured that one. That's his own that he coloured. But the idea is that you can then sit and colour it. So So it's two, it's different concepts, as you can see. So, I mean, there's the idea of creating your own mandala, which is like the Jungian idea of therapy. And then you have like a mandala that's with the sound, because you're energizing the balls of sound within you and all around you, and then healing and whatnot as well. It's all very therapeutic. And then you've got the idea of actually meditating with a mandala. So while you're doing it, you allow your mind to be free. So although you've got some constrictions because there's a design, you're picking the colors and you're thinking about the meaning of each symbol. So if we look at the symbolism here, it's pretty interesting. So he's got a lot of the ideas from what is called the tabula smaragdina hermeticus. So this is the emerald tablet, which apparently they were returned to their rightful home of the Great Pyramid in the 1920s. It's made of a green material that does not corrode. And I'll explain why I brought that up in a moment. And so he's got the eyes, you know, from those ideas. And when you look, you read around it from the top right, it says visitor, interiora, terra, rectificando, invenius, and occultum lapidum. So what it means is when you visit the interior of the earth, thus rectifying yourself, you will find the hidden stone or the philosopher's stone. So in the alchemical way of understanding ourselves is very different to, say, Buddhism or Tibetan way of looking at things, where it's the same and different. It's just using different language. It's like the philosopher's stone is that within us, so we're trying to find it, and there's just different ways to approach the same thing. It's really very interesting. So, well, I think it is. I hope you do. But you can see at the top there, like there's the sun and the moon kind of pouring into a kind of a chalice. So that's the Holy Grail. So this whole thing about King Arthur and Sir Lancelot and how they're running around the countryside looking for this golden goblet, it's actually, you know, this concept of how we run around doing lots of things and then we find out it's all within us. Yeah, so that's really the idea here. And, of course, this is my interpretations. As I say, we all have different interpretations. I'm just giving you mine. And then you've got symbols there, like you've got the masculine and the feminine, and the sun and the moon is also considered to be the masculine and the feminine, and it can be the light and the dark, the good and the bad, the positive and the negative. But besides, you know, we live in a world of duality, so recognising this polarity or this duality in which we live. Now, we've got our hands like this. So, of course, this is a mudra. And I was really fascinated when I went to Italy. I was really looking at all the went to a lot of different churches and galleries. It was just amazing. And I was fascinated by looking at the hand gestures because, I've done 20 years of training in yoga and we learn all different kinds of mudras with our hands. And you go somewhere and there in all the churches are the different hand mudras. So this one, according to a yogic understanding, is prana mudra. So it's bringing the energy from the universe in. So it's the prana mudra. Yeah, this one. So if you meditate, and you could try it later sometime, where you have one hand on your lap and the other one like this, and just, you're just allowing your higher consciousness, the great central sun or the universe or whatever it is that you consider to be much greater than yourself, you're kind of directing it to come in. And, of course, it can be directed out to things too. That's another thing. Okay, and then we've got some different symbols. So on the bottom left there, can you see the two-headed eagle, double-headed eagle, the red and white one? So I'll just go to another page and I'll just talk about that. Okay, so the double-headed eagle you can see there. So this symbol is everywhere. If you go, you can go like it's in Greece. There's the idea that Zeus had was trying to find the center of the earth. So he got two eagles and they flew around the world and they both came back to Delphi. So Delphi, according to Zeus, was the center of the world. You see it in Mexico. You'll see it on the top of staffs in different churches and on seats and everywhere you go. So this one clearly comes from a more Masonic kind of drawing. It's because you've got your 3-3, and there you go, you've got your number symbolism. So like we've got 33 vertebrae in our spine, and 3 + 3 makes a 6, which is a master number. Okay, I'll just go back a page. So you can also see above the seven-pointed star to the right of the double-headed eagle, you can see that like globe with a cross on the top. So that one, that's the Globus Crucibus. So if you see this painting here by Leonardo da Vinci, and it's called Salvator Mundi, so that's the salvation of the world, and the Globus Crucibus is like the cross above the world. So it's the idea of like the Christ consciousness that's coming into the world. And you can see here again this symbol, so bringing down the energy, the prana mudra. Okay. All right, so I wanted to also indicate here, so you can see on the right here where it says tabula smaragdina, the emerald tablet. So a lot of this ideas comes from Hermes Trismegistus. So that's the thrice born, the ibis-headed god from Egyptians is another of the manifestations. And so the concept of as above, also so below, comes from here. So you can consider, when I look at that, I can see there's like the sun and the moon at the top, and down the bottom I can see like the world and the earth. So, you know, there's like an above and a below. So there's like a divine coming into consciousness, perhaps. I mean, it's endless possibilities. Now, can you see the green lion? See the green lion? Okay. So the green lion devours the sun. Now, when you look at the green lion, how many red stars does he have on his body?
Seven.
That's right. Yeah, and I just want to show you back here. Yes, you see the seven-pointed star. So the number seven being significant. So there's seven stars on the lion that's devouring the sun. And so we could imagine that, you know, like the sun comes up and it goes down, so it's like going into the water. But in alchemy, it's about sulfuric acid. It's the and also related to copper sulfate, but a substance that will dissolve anything except gold. So that's why gold was considered to be most precious. Okay, and then the bottom left there, I've got the red king and the white queen. So it's another concept that's used about this concept of duality in the masculine and the feminine. There's your seven-pointed star. It's also called the elven star. So you can actually, because you can draw it in one line and make seven. And so, in fact, it's as above, so below. And so it's like within and God consciousness, and you've got north, south, east, and west. So anyway, I've got it written down, but yeah, the seven points, all to do with like our direction and then coming back to our center. And there you can see it's also related to the chariot. So the chariot is a number seven. And on the right side, that little glyph, so you've got seven, the chariot, and the little glyph. Do you know what the glyph is? Here? Okay, that's the Hebrew number for seven. So just looking at that and see, again, there's this idea of this polarity. All right. So what I'm trying to say to you, I hope this is making sense, is that you can meditate while you, if you have something that has some depth. So, adult coloring books are great. But things like this, you really start inquiring within. Okay, now the number seven, I want to just go on a little bit more there. So on the tree of life, which has a whole lot of spheres called the sephirot, so the different spheres that are all connected. So again, this mandala, this circle shape. So the one on the right there, netzach, which is green, relating to the planet Venus and with love. And then when I was looking up to when I was looking up to find out more information about Net Such, I discovered this anime character, Korean anime character, that's her name is Net Such, and she's a green unhappy schoolgirl. So I thought that was really funny and just had to put it in there. But you know how these ancient ideas can still, there's some underpinning of what we're doing now. But the unfortunate thing is that she's a really miserable looking schoolgirl. She could have been a goddess of love or something. So it's been modified as well. Okay, now how are we going with time? All right, so this is a meditation. I think we might have to skip this maybe, or I can come back. But this is a meditation, so you can see all these lines. Like, I'll just point them out. Hang on. So, like, starting from here, and you go to there, and then to there, and then to there, and then to there, all the way around. Then you go from here to there, to there, to there, to there, all the way around. So that's the seven, the letters of the Hebrew alphabet. And so the first one is Aleph, next one's Bet, Aleph, Gimel, Aleph, you know, and so you can see where alphabet came from, Aleph, Bet. And it's actually a sphere, and it comes from the Sefer Yetzirah, and it talks, and when you do this meditation, and if you know, I don't think we'll get time today, but if you want me to send you a link, I can just send me an email, but it's so powerful. You look at the image, and then the meditation just has each letter, and you just say it with her, just say it, and it takes you to a very deep state. It all is about what you kind of connect to. So I find that the sounds of the Hebrew letters, for whatever reason, I really resonate with them. So it's just a thing that might be something you'd like to try. So there's many ways to come to the same place. All right, so this is the last alchemical drawing I'll show you today. So this is from Azoth the philosopher. It was drawn by Basil Valentine in 1659. And so you can see here again the seven-pointed star. The alchemist is in the centre. And you can see this, you know, the anima and the spiritus, so the male and the female. And then in between each point, these are the seven stages of alchemy. So in pictogram kind of form. And you can see that he's got one foot in the water and one on the land. So there's a lot of symbolism there. And you can see there's a lot of meaning in the different symbols too. So this is another one that can be just drawn like black drawing, and then you colour it in. So this one somebody's coloured in, and again thinking about what it means. And even if you don't know, you haven't done any reading about what the symbols mean, on they're archetypal, so it means on some level you will resonate them with them, and you create your own understanding. Sometimes by not knowing as much can be very good too. On the right there, that's the monad. So this is a symbol that's considered that if you sit and meditate with it, it can bring you to enlightenment. So many ways to come to enlightenment. So this was drawn by John Dee in 1564. So it represents everything. Like you've got the moon at the top, you've got the sun, but if you put them together, it's Taurus. You've got the cross. At the bottom, you've got this shape that can be Aries. And then you've got the north, south, east, west, because you've got like the quadrants. And he was actually the astrologer for Queen Victoria the First. Queen Elizabeth, yeah, thank you. Oh, look at that. So here we've got our Theosophical emblem. So I love this. And so we've got the snake eating its own tail, the Ouroboros. So the concept of there being no beginning or no end, of reincarnation, of birth and rebirth, of perfection, of finding your own perfection of the self, so many different concepts with the snake eating its own tail. And above that you have the swastika. Yes.
I believe that one's actually called the selvastika. Because if the hand is turning left, it's selvastika, and if it's turning right, it's swastika.
Oh, okay. All right. Yeah. Absolutely. And why not? Yeah. So, the Nazi one, they flipped them around to be war instead of peace. I think most people know about that. So, and we saw earlier on how it's like something that's flowing or moving. In the above that, you've got like an om and a shri symbol. So, which is like, for example, I used to be a disciple of Sri Sri Ravi Shankar, so that like the honorific name for someone who's a guru. So Sri, meaning sir, or madam, something like that. But that which is all high or has knowledge. In the center there, the Ankh. So you've probably seen, I'm sure you have seen those paintings from Egyptian temples where they have the person. And then there's this really big person handing them an Ankh, and it's actually eternal life. So this concept of eternal life, coming back again and again. There's lots of different renditions of this symbol as well. So, of course, this is also something that can be a meditation where you can sit and colour it in with some music and just see what comes up. I like this one because, to me, it has the rays of the sun, so that's really appealing. So the snake is also related to the cosmic egg. So you have the idea of like in different countries in the world, they might talk about a snake that goes around the whole world. So this idea of like it's not the chicken and the egg, that's how I say it, being all-encompassing. On the right there, that's a painting by Hildegard von Bingham, did I say that right? I think so, I hope so. So she's an amazing mystic from, what was that, 1098 to 1179 she was alive, and she had visions and then got someone to draw those visions. So that's also like a cosmic egg. And in yoga, there's a yoga posture called the cosmic egg. You just sort of, like you can see there, and it actually makes you feel really peaceful when you do it. It's a very simple posture, but you feel really at peace when you do that particular posture. Okay, so a little about the star. So we have the six-pointed star this time instead of the seven. So we have like the ones coming down to do with the earth and water, and ones going up, the fire and the air. And then I have symbols here of the Merkaba. So that is the three-dimensional image of the triangle, and they rotate in one direction and the other, and they say that depending on your gender, they spin in one way or another. But that's what some people say. And then, of course, we've got our alchemical version of the same thing. So the Merkaba being the chariot of light, which also relates to number seven, the chariot. So being able to lift ourselves up from this earthly existence. And just some mandalas you can see from everywhere. The one on the left is obviously Aussie, oi, oi, oi. So our Australian Aboriginal art. At the top right there, the Aztecs. And then if you look at Isis, I mean, it's this curving shape like a mandala as well, because, I mean, she's not just holding her wings. There's this energy that's enveloping her. So Jung's Red Book, he has these images of mandalas that he drew. So what do they say to you now? What do they say? You talk to a neighbour for a second, pick out one or two, or what do you think? What do you think was going on in his life? Or maybe just tell me, what do you think was happening in his life? Was he happy or sad? Right, was... what do you think? Come on, just don't think too much. Sorry? Sad? Okay. Now tell me something else. What was happening in his life?
Curious.
Curious, would you say?
Curious.
Process?
Yeah,
flowering?
A little waves, it's like he's underwater.
Yeah, which could be the subconscious, for example. Yeah.
Reminds me of the Tower of Terror or something.
Uh-huh. Oh, like an explosion.
Yeah,
that bottom right one. Yeah. Okay, good. Yeah, so once we start thinking about, you know, it gets more and more interesting. I love to look at logos and think, I wonder what that might mean. Or, you know, you see lots of information all around us that are telling us things, and when we just open our minds to the possibility. So this is the last slide for this evening. So some mandala art. So this is also a couple of images I took from the textbook here. So, you know, the book is here in the library. So this is just a couple of mandalas that Hayter Kopany made. And you can see the one on the left, you've got your mandala in that square kind of shape. It's called a yantra. So the Indians, as well as the Tibetans, like to draw yantras. They say it's a way of trying to physicalize something that you can't really understand. So you're making something square that was round. It's very interesting, and when you colour, there's many different types of yantras. That's a Sri yantra, which is the most famous one. But there are many different yantras. So so if you're interested in coming along to a workshop on mantras, there is a sign up sheet just over there. I haven't decided which day. I just want to see that there's some people, because I need some people to do it. And just $5 for materials. And there's on the bottom floor there we have a creative space. So I will bring some paper with images on it, and you can choose whatever you like and do like a meditation. And we can also do something more freeform, like from Jung. So, yeah, that's it. Thank you.
Are there any questions for Julia? Yes, Amy?
On the art I saw in the Middle East, mm-hmm. Islamic bones, and the mantras are not all the art with the bones.
Yeah, everything's a curve, and you've got all those domes. Yeah, I was just thinking as you're speaking about our Easter eggs, you know, because that's the concept of the world, or a totality, or a self, or creation. Yes.
I like your dress. It looks like a mantra.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. I was trying to get something like the lotus, sort of Egyptian lotus.
Do you have any? You draw mantras, and do you have any on your computer?
I don't have any. I mean, I've done some, but then I've thrown them away. So, I tend to draw a drawing and then I chuck it. But, we'll have this workshop and come along, have some fun, and do some drawings, and we can put them up on the screen for everyone to see. Oh, no. Yes.
I noticed some of those mandala arrangements were a little bit like a crop circle. Don't think they
very much. Yeah. Oh, there's still plenty of them, I believe. It's just that they're not so publicised. They're keeping them quiet. Yeah, but some of the design, I'd forgotten about that. Yeah, crop circles are a perfect example. So people say that's a way of communicating to us, you know, and whether or not we can understand or resonate with those symbols. So it's universal.
There's an enormous yantra in Utah. Have you heard of that?
No.
Has anyone heard of it? In Utah, they found this enormous, like nearly a kilometer wide yantra that just appeared suddenly, like a crop circle, but a complete, perfect yantra.
Wow, amazing.
Would you be able to tell us any more about your musical mandala workshop? What you'll be doing?
So it'll be run on a Sunday afternoon, so over the next month. In the next 2 or 3 weeks. So just anyone who's interested, write your name down and I'll contact you. If I haven't met you before, make sure you write down your email so I know who I'm talking to. We're going to basically do do the meditation we didn't get a chance to do, the 231 gates, which is really amazing. And then I'll have lots of different drawings for you to choose. and you can do as many as you like, and then we'll do a free drawing. So I think it's easier to come from structure before we go to unstructured. So we'll get ourselves into the zone, and then structure, and then no structure. Yeah. And then we can interpret each other's drawings. Yes. Mm. Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. So, because you've got the horizon line. Well, Nikki knows all about this, and what's above and what's below, and so all of that exists as well. And it's all in a circle, yeah. And you start noticing after a while everything has a circle design somewhere. Mm. All right. Any more questions? Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.